And that ultimately what happened was is that that people group known as the Hebrews of that time became slaves in Egypt. Okay, there was a famine in the land. You'll remember in the story of Joseph and how God gave Joseph a special position and gave him revelation of the dream of Pharaoh, and didn't only give him revelation of the dream, but gave him wisdom on how to handle the situation. That there was going to be famine, and then there was going to be time of plenty, and then a time of famine, and how to handle the wisdom to fix the situation. And because of that, the Pharaoh elevated him. And we know that there became that during that great dearth or that famine in the land, that what ended up happening is that Jacob and his other boys, who had actually betrayed Joseph, went back to Egypt, and there they found favor in Pharaoh's eyes. And actually, an entire piece of property was given to them, known as the land of Goshen, for them to be able to raise their sheep and things of that nature. Now, for 400 years, they dwelled or lived in Egypt. But there came a time, according to the scripture, where a new Pharaoh came in charge, a Pharaoh that did not know Joseph. And he began to enslave the children of Israel and began to put them to work, making bricks so that he could build all of his monuments and things of that nature. That's whenever God rose up Moses. We know that story. And through Moses, we have the time frame of the Exodus, correct? And that God delivered the children of Israel out. We said this is about somewhere around 1450 BC. These numbers aren't necessarily always exact. Some people say 1801 Abraham, but you get the point. There was about a 400-year difference here. And what ends up happening is that there's this time frame of the Exodus, and really and truly what was supposed to be about a 2 to 3 day journey turns into 40 years. 40 years of wandering in a wilderness. Very typical, very typological, if you will, of the Christian journey, whenever you give your heart to Christ, because that's really what the Exodus night was all about. The Passover night, the shedding of the blood of the Lamb, symbolic or typological of the shedding of Jesus' blood that delivered us out from the world system and into the kingdom of God. And that God always has a desire for his people to enter into his promises, known as the promised land, which is also was previously the place of Israel, known as the land of Canaan. Okay, so God had a place that he was bringing his people, but because of their refusal to listen to him, and listen, this is repeated, thematic, throughout the entirety of the scripture. God's people just don't listen to him the way they're supposed to.
Come on.
And if I can get just somebody to say amen with me, then you and I can all be on the same page, and we can come to the realization that it wasn't just them, it's us too. That we as the people of God don't listen to the Lord the way that we're supposed to. But he is merciful, he's kind, he's tender loving, and I got to tell you this morning, if you don't know anything else from this morning's message, because I know sometimes I talk too much, you need to understand that this beautiful plan that God has is a plan that is based upon love. Many times when we hear the language of the Bible, it's some people feel like, oh, that's harsh. No, God's not harsh. God is a loving God. He's tender, loving, he's kind, he's got a beautiful plan. But the truth of the matter is that he's holy and he will judge sin. Amen. Now the good news is that his loving kindness judged sin on Jesus at Calvary. That was always his plan. But her that refuses to embrace that form of judgment for their sin will then face judgment for their own sin as they stand on their own in the face of God. Naked you came into the world, and naked you will also leave, and you will stand. That's what the idea of nakedness, by the way, I think I might preach a message on that coming up soon, is the idea of exposure.
Yeah.
Nakedness is being exposed, because the truth of the matter is that when Adam and Eve realized that they were naked, it was because their sin had now been exposed. Many times, many scholars believe that they would have been clothed with the glory of God before the fall took place. And there's another thematic, I don't mean to get off the beaten path, but there's another thematic approach in the scripture of the clothing of the people of God. Progressively clothing them from fig leaves won't work to animal skins will at the type of a sacrifice to ultimately in the end we're clothed in white robes of righteousness that we have received through the salvation of Jesus. He's also clothed. When he comes back for his church, what's he clothed in? In a vesture. He's clothed in a garment that's dipped in blood, because it was his blood that was shed that allowed the righteousness to be given to the saints. But So the Exodus takes place, and what was supposed to last about 2 to 3 day journey ends up being 40 years, and there's this wandering in the wilderness. Now, I have to tell you that if you go to the book of Deuteronomy, I'm not telling you to do that, but if you did and you went to chapter 28, verses 1 through 14 begins to explain to the children of Israel before they're finally going to enter into the promised land of Canaan, that God explains to them that there's blessings and there's curses. If you will hearken diligently, the word hearken means that not only do your ears have auditory functioning, in other words, the vibrations hitting your tympanic membrane, it's vibrating the ossicles of your ear, which taps this stuff called perilymph and tickles these little hair-like sensations that send the signal to your brain, tell you to hear, that's working. But even in addition to that, you're submitting to or hearkening, you're submitting yourself to the words that are being spoken, amen? And so I just want you to know that he said that those that will hearken diligently to the words that I give you, then you're going to be blessed. Blessed will you be coming in. Blessed will you be going out. I'm going to bless your storehouses. I'm going to bless your increase. I'm going to bless your offspring. I'm going to bless your produce. I'm going to bless. But if you don't, then you're going to be cursed. And all of the curses that I promised that would not be put upon you, they're going to be put upon you. And so the reality of it is that for you and I today, what we need to understand is that God's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Yeah. And in his covenant, while it doesn't go down exactly the way that it did in the old covenant, there is the basic principle that when the people of God are obedient to him and his will, are obedient to his word and how he operates in his covenant, then there's a blessing that awaits them. On the other hand, whenever his people are not obedient to him and his covenant, then there is cursings that follow. Many times when we find ourselves in circumstances, I'll kind of get ahead of myself, we've inflicted ourselves. And I'm not saying that in every situation, if you're going through something bad right now and you say, hey, preacher, hold on, slow down, I didn't do anything wrong right here. Okay, the world that we live on is fallen, and many times you'll find yourself in situations that maybe you didn't initiate. But the reality of it is that many times when we find ourselves in circumstances, we did. We inflicted ourselves based upon the choices that we made, all right? And so, but what I want you to know is that God finally did bring them into the land that he had promised them. And then we enter into the time frame of the kings. Now, if you'll remember the big thing about Solomon, many of you already know what happened, but Solomon did some bad things. We're not going to get into all the details of it, but what happened because of what Solomon did? Y'all remember? The kingdom was split. Yeah. Remember that? The kingdom was split, and you had a northern kingdom. The northern kingdom was known as Israel. That's supposed to be northern. And the southern kingdom was known as Judah. And throughout the entirety of the book of the Kings, we see repeated references to the kings of Israel, the northern kingdom, and the kings of Judah. The kings of Israel were the ones that were really, they weren't part of the promised lineage. God had always promised that the king, talking about Jesus, would come from Judah. All right. And so these other kings in Israel were false kings, and they were actually a false way. And they represented that because they caused the people to worship false gods. Okay. And so the people went after the gods of the world. Well, God had told them in Deuteronomy, don't do what they do. As a matter of fact, if you could put on the screen Leviticus chapter 18, I'll just show you. This is a good example of how the Lord, 18, 1 through 5, if you have it in your Bibles, you can just turn there. And I wanted to just give you an example of what I'm trying to say. So this is before the Deuteronomy passage. This is actually during the time frame of the Exodus, the book of Leviticus is. And so Lord, God knows that he's going to be bringing his people into the land of Canaan. And he again explains, and this is what he says, and the Lord spoke unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel, and say unto them, I am the Lord your God. After the doings of the land of Egypt, wherein you dwelt, shall you not do. In other words, the things that they used to do in the place where you used to live, when I bring you into the new place, you're not supposed to do that anymore. All right? And after the doings of the land of Canaan, where I bring you, you shall not do. So you're not supposed to do the things of your past. And then when I bring you into the new place of the land, because I'm about to disperse those people, I'm about to move them out, move you in. And he goes on to say in the book of Leviticus, the reason I'm going to do that is because they're polluting the land. The people that are living there now are living in gross idolatry. They're living in a way that is not pleasing unto me. I'm about to move them out, and I'm about to put my people in there, because he's wanting a people that will live for him and represent him and be light in the midst of a darkened world. He says, where I bring you shall you not do, now neither shall you walk in their ordinances. In other words, don't walk according to their ways. You shall do my judgments and keep my ordinances to walk therein. I am the Lord your God. Ordinances and statutes and judgments all are reflective of the fact that God has given his word to his people. Amen. This is how we know the heart of God. This is how we know the mind of God. He's communicated himself, his character, his holiness, how he is, what he desires through his word. Amen. Therefore, as his people, we must learn his word in order to understand how to walk with him in a pleasing way. Now, the reality of it is that's what Solomon did. I wasn't going to get into it, but the reality of it is that Solomon did all the stuff God told them not to do. He started off by marrying foreign women. God had repeatedly told Israel, don't do it. Why? Not because it's a problem if you fall in love with some Saudi Arabian girl. The problem is that if you fall in love with some Saudi Arabian girl and her God is Allah instead of Jesus, that's the problem. Because she's going to draw your heart away from the God who loves you and died for you. And God knew that was going to happen. Well, Solomon didn't listen. And what he did was, before it was over, he built altars to those false gods. And because of that, the kingdom was split. And so where we are in the time frame of Hosea, it's about 715 B.C. Now, one of the things that I'll tell you is that in 726 B.C., what's going to happen is that's when the Assyrian army, which is up north, is going to come and take the northern kingdom, Israel, captive, make them prisoners, enslave them, okay, take away their freedom. And spiritually, this happens to people all the time. They start off thinking that whatever it is that they're doing is fun. They start off thinking that it feels good to them. They have a desire to be like the world around them. They start to partake of what's there, and what started off as feeling good to the flesh ultimately results in becoming enslaved, finding themselves in captivity and finding themselves in bondage, and there's no longer any freedom at all connected to it. And so that's the environment, if you will, when the prophet Hosea is called upon God to prophesy to God's people. Basically, the people of God, Israel, and even Judah, the southern kingdom, is not doing what they're supposed to do either. They're following a little bit after the ways of the northern kingdom. And God is using the prophets to repeatedly warn them and tell them. So God's people are basically cheating on him, is what you could say. There's adultery taking place. They're sleeping with another god. They're having relationship with another god. They're going after another way. Now, in order to preach this properly, you know, I'm kind of, once again, getting ahead of myself, and maybe some things will be repetitive, but I want to be real clear. How does that equate to us, preacher? Because the reality of it is that I don't have like a little statue in my house that I'm bowing down to. I understand that. But what you got to understand is that what the children of Israel are literally doing is that they are finding, they are putting their hope in the gods of the world to provide their for them as to be their resources, to be their source of what it is that they need. What do you mean? They're an agricultural society. They need rain. They need rain in order to produce harvest. So therefore, instead of serving and trusting in God, they're serving now and trusting in Baal, the fertility and storm god. They believe he will bring them rain. They've learned from the people around them. They started to do what God told them not to do. Don't do the ordinances of the people where I bring you. And now they're engaging in this perverted form of religious worship in order to call upon Baal to let the rain come so that they can have their fertile crops. what do the children of God oftentimes do? Because really we're preaching to the church this morning. I'll be perfectly honest with you. Because see, the Canaanite don't know no better. All he knows to do is beat his drum and go into some frenzied, well, it just is what it is. We're pretty much an older crowd in here. A frenzied orgy in order to summon the God. That's what they did. That's how they worshiped their false gods. And in order to summon the prosperity of these false gods. Well, the reality of it is that none of us are really going to try to serve a false god in that way. But what we will do is we'll turn to the world for resources.
Yep.
We'll turn to the world and the world's ways in order to try to get our needs fulfilled. The needs that we think we have, instead of trusting in his ordinances and his judgments and his ways. And this can be broken down in a lot of different ways. We will turn to the ways of the world and what the world offers, instead of trusting in God and what it is that he wants to provide for his people, in order to fill the voids and to take care of the problems that we have in the midst of our lives, okay? And in a moment, I think maybe we'll get a little bit more clear on there. But you know, sometimes you got to use your own imagination. Sometimes you got to use your own imaginations. You got to start thinking about some of the things that you've done in your life. And I need to think about the things that I've done in my life, even as a Christian, that haven't really been of faith, but that instead have been learning how to trust in something else other than the Lord to provide for me. One of my favorite things, and I'm not trying to pick on women, but it's something that I learned. So if you're a single woman in here, I don't see a lot of single women. But this is one of the things that the Lord really put on my heart for single women once they give their heart to the Lord. All right. This is what ends up happening, is that because nowadays it's not uncommon for people to cohabit with one another outside of marriage. It's just a common thing. It don't make it right. The word of God is real clear on what's right and wrong. It's wrong. I mean, the word of God says the marriage bed is undefiled. The word of God says fornicators will not enter the kingdom of heaven. I didn't write it. The Lord wrote it. Preachers may not want to talk about it now, but it is the word of the living God. Amen? Well, so, but now the norm of society, see, once again, here we go. The Canaanite says that it's okay. Don't walk after their ordinances or their judgments. The point that I'm trying to make is this. Many times, single women, before they come to the Lord, have learned a process of behavior to become dependent upon a man through those types of relationships. Not that women can't work and make their own money. There's women I know that make more money than men. That's not what I'm saying. The point that I'm trying to make, though, is that it can be a common finding for a woman to learn to become dependent upon. I know psychology calls it codependence. I'm just calling it sin. But they become dependent upon the resources of a man. Does that make sense what I'm saying? Somebody is shaking your head. You know I'm telling you the truth. I ain't lying over here. I know. I've seen it. I can see it. And I've talked to women before after they came to the Lord. They stay in these kind of relationships. They still find themselves a relationship, even in they don't separate from the man that they were with. They continue to live in that particular circumstance because they don't have a clue on how it is that they would ever get out. How am I going to pay my bills, preacher? You got to learn how to trust in the Lord instead of the Canaanite god named Baal. And the fact of the matter is that this is a perfect analogy. That's just one for the women. I don't really know what I'm sure I can find one for men, but that, none of this was in my notes. You get the point. Men do probably even much worse stuff than men. They're more worried about their flesh and how they're going to fix their sexual needs. And at least the woman's trying to pay her bills, okay? But the fact of the matter is this. Is that there are ways that people look to what the world says is okay, which is actually contrary to what the Word of God says is the way things are to be done, and they tend to be perfectly fine with it. They tend to be perfectly fine with it, and they continue to live that way, but it's contrary to the Word of God. Does that make sense? All right. So that's the scenario that we're in the book of Hosea when we read these first three chapters, and I just want you to be aware of that. And then when we're done, we'll just break down a few little spots, okay? All right. Chapter 1, verse 1. The word of the Lord that came unto Hosea, the son of Beeri, in the days of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah, kings of Judah, and in the days of Jeroboam, the son of Joash, king of Israel. The beginning of the word of the Lord by Hosea, and the Lord said to Hosea, go, take unto thee a wife of whoredoms and children of whoredoms, for the land has committed great whoredom, departing from the Lord. So he went and took Gomer, the daughter of Diblaim, which conceived and bare him a son. And the Lord said unto him, call his name Jezreel, for yet a little while, and I will avenge the blood of Jezreel upon the house of Jehu, and will cause to cease the kingdom of the house of Israel. And it shall come to pass that day that I will break the bow of Israel in the valley of Jezreel. And she conceived again and bare a daughter. And God said unto him, call her name Lo-ruhamah, for I will no more have mercy upon the house of Israel, but I will utterly take them away. But I will have mercy upon the house of Judah, and will save them by the Lord their God, and will not save them by bow, nor by sword, nor by battle, by horses, nor by horsemen. Now when she had weaned Lo-ruhamah, she conceived and bare a son. Then said God, call his name Lo-ammi, for you are not my people, and I will not be your God. Yet the number of the children of Israel shall be as the sand of the sea, which cannot be measured nor numbered. And it shall come to pass that in the place where it was said unto them, you are not my people, there it shall be said unto them, you are the sons of the living God. Then shall the children of Judah and the children of Israel be gathered together and appoint themselves one head, and they shall come up out of the land, for great shall be the day of Jezreel. Now, just real quick, this is not part of my message, but what I want you to know is that that is a prophetic speaking of the day in the future when Messiah, Jesus, will return, and Israel and Judah will be united as a nation, and he will be their king, and they will recognize him, the Savior of the world, as their king. Amen. But for the purposes that I really want you to get out of that is this. There's a certain place where God said, you're not my people. But it's in that same place he said, I'm going to call you my people. Okay, I want you to just hold on to that. All right, chapter 2, verse 1. Say ye unto your brethren, am I, and to your sisters, Ruhamah, plead with your mother, plead, for she is not my wife, neither am I her husband. Let her therefore put away her whoredoms out of her sight, and her adulteries from between her breasts, lest I strip her naked and set her as in the day that she was born, and make her as a wilderness, and set her like a dry land, and slay her with thirst. And I will not have mercy upon her children, for they be the children of whoredoms. For their mother has played the harlot. She that conceived them has done shamefully. For she said, I will go after my lovers that give me bread, and my water, my wool, and my flax, my oil, and my drink. Therefore, behold, I will hedge up thy way with thorns. In other words, I'm going to put obstacles of thorns in your way. I will make a wall that she shall not find her paths, and she shall follow after her lovers, but she shall not overtake them. She shall seek them, but shall not find them. Then shall she say, I will go and return to my first husband, for then was it better with me than now. You know, it's just too good not to stop right here for a second and to make a point. You think that God doesn't allow people in their own free will to go the way that they want to go, but at the same time, he's purposely putting up a hedge of thorns. He's purposely putting up a wall to make sure that you don't ultimately find what it is that you're looking for in the way the passage is calling it, your lover, the thing that you think is going to bring you what it is that you're searching for. God puts an obstacle in the way and says, you're not going to find it, and that ultimately you're going to come to the place where you're going to realize I had it a whole lot better whenever I was desiring to serve the Lord than whenever I was going after this other stuff. He says in verse 8, for she did not know that I gave her corn and wine and oil and multiplied her silver and gold, which they prepared for Baal. Therefore will I return and take away my corn in the time thereof, and my wine in the season thereof, and I will recover my wool and my flax given to cover her nakedness. And now will I discover her lewdness in the sight of her lovers, and none shall deliver her out of my hand. I will also cause all her mirth to cease, her feast days, her new moons, and her Sabbaths, and all her solemn feasts. You see what's going on there, right? This is all part of the Jewish worship system. Sabbaths, new moons, these feasts, all this, the moons and the cycle of the moons had to do with the timing of the various feasts. The feasts represented the time when they would come together to worship the Lord. It was supposed to be a time of great joy. The point is that, listen, they have intermingled their religion so much with the ways of the world that they don't know the difference between the fact that they're not really serving God anymore and they're just going through the motions of traditional religion. How many times do people get dressed, show up, go to church, and they're going through the motions of traditional religion, but the reality of it is, like God told Isaiah, there's a people that draw near me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. God wants a people whose hearts are close to Him. Amen. Praise God. He says, I will also, verse 11, I will also cause her mirth to cease, her feast days, her new moons, and her Sabbaths, and all her solemn feasts. I will destroy her vines and her fig trees, whereof she has said, these are my rewards that my lovers have given me, and I will make them a forest, and the beasts of the field shall eat them. And I will visit upon her the days of Balaam, wherein she burned incense to them. And she decked herself with earrings and her jewels, and she went after her lovers, and she forgot me, saith the Lord. Therefore, behold, I will allure her and bring her into the wilderness and speak comfortably unto her. Now, that word allure, it has kind of a negative connotation, but in this sense, it's actually being used like God is actually enticing her. He's saying, come to me. It's almost like in the midst of all of this, because I know this is some harsh language, what we're hearing. It's like, man, God's really mad. Yeah, He's mad. But at the same time, He's going back and forth. He's saying, this is what you're doing, but this is how I love you. When He's saying, I'm going to allure her, I'm going to entice her, the idea is He's trying to draw her away. Kind of like in the Song of Solomon. In the Song of Solomon, He spoke to His future bride. He said, arise. He said, the winter is over. The rain has stopped. Arise. Come unto me. You know, be my bride. This is what the Lord is trying to cry out to His people. And He's saying, I will entice her. I will tell her to come and to bring her into the wilderness, and I will speak comfortably unto her. And verse 15, and I will give her her vineyards from there, and the valley of Achor for a door of hope. I want you to pay attention to that. I'm going to break it down here in a second. So He's going to turn the valley of Achor into a door of hope. And she shall sing there as in the days of her youth, and as in the day when she came up out of the land of Egypt. I can tell you right now, I know things got bad in the wilderness experience. I know the children of Israel really did murmur and complain a whole lot. But I'm telling you right now, on their first few days of that journey, there was some happiness and some singing going on. Whenever the Lord had delivered them out of the hand of Pharaoh, and they had previously been slaves, whenever they found themselves up against that Red Sea and the cliff on two sides and Pharaoh's army coming upon them, and Moses lifted up that rod and the Red Sea parted and they walked over on dry ground, and then on the backside, the waters closed up on Pharaoh and chariots were swirling in the waters underneath, and Pharaoh's army was destroyed. And then Miriam and the women got out their tambourines and began to sing songs unto the Lord as they marched towards the promise. There was a happy and a joyous celebration that was taking place. And what the Lord's saying is, there's coming a day when I'm going to allure her. I'm going to tell her, hey, I still want to be married to you. Won't you still come unto me? And it's going to be the happiness that you had when you first got saved. Right. When you first gave your heart to the Lord. Hallelujah. The Lord told the church of Ephesus, I got this one thing against you. You left your first love. The Lord wants our hearts to be knitted to His heart. Amen. And He wants our love to be like it was in the first love. And so even though many times we find ourselves falling away, far away from the things of God, He's constantly calling on us. And He's saying, won't you come unto me? Right. Won't you remember the day when you first got saved? Won't you remember the day whenever the burden was lifted off your back and you felt the freedom that I had brought unto you? God wants you to remember that day. Amen. He says right here, and verse 16, and it shall be at that day, saith the Lord, that thou shalt call me Ishai, and shalt call me no more Bela, for I will take away the names of Balaam out of her mouth, and they shall no more be remembered by their name. And in that day I will make a covenant for them with the beasts of the field, with the fowls of heaven, with the creeping things of the ground. I will break the bow and the sword and the battle out of the earth, and I will make them to lie down safely, and I will betroth thee unto me forever. Yea, I will betroth thee unto me in righteousness and in judgment, and in loving kindness and in mercies. So what I want you to see, this is a beautiful picture that we're having here. He reminds us back to the time frame of Egypt, all right? And essentially what God did at that point in time was he married himself a bride named Israel. He married himself a people and he delivered her out of the hand of Pharaoh, out of the system of the world. But at the same time, she repeatedly commits adultery on him. And what he's saying is this, is that even though you committed adultery on me, even though you went away from me, what I need you to know is that there's coming a day whenever I'm going to call you and you're going to respond. And when you respond, I'm going to betroth you. It's going to be like we started all over again. It's going to be like a brand new. See, the betrothal is like our engagement, but it's even more. They were literally married. They just hadn't consummated the marriage yet. He said, I'm going to betroth you unto me. I'm going to court you again. I'm going to come after you. I'm going to move upon you by my spirit and draw you back towards me. All right. And so he says right here, verse 21, and it shall come to pass in that day, I will hear, saith the Lord, I will hear the heavens, and they shall hear the earth, and the earth shall hear the corn, and the wine and the oil, they shall hear Jezreel. And I will sow her unto me in the earth, and I will have mercy upon her that had not obtained mercy. And I will say to them which were not my people, thou art my people, and they shall say, thou art my God. All right, now we're turning to chapter 3. So in the midst of all of that, so far what we've seen is a specific time frame where God's people are being spiritually unfaithful to him. And he's saying that even in the midst of your spiritual unfaithfulness, I don't know where you've gone, but I just want you to know I still want to have a relationship with you. And so that's what God would speak to each and every one of us, no matter where we are in our walk with the Lord, that he's always saying, I would still want to have a relationship with you. Now we got to remember the prophet that he's called in this time frame. What did he tell him to do? He told him, go get yourself a wife of whoredoms. Go get yourself, I want you to marry an adulterous woman. I want you to connect yourself to her. I want you to have offspring with her. Now, I can tell you that the reason that God did this, you can say, well, that's kind of unfair. Here he is. He's a child of God. God's going to use this man of God as an illustrative sermon for the people of God, because even though God's voice keeps speaking, God's people don't listen. And so he's saying, surely if I can give them an illustrative sermon and use the prophet of God as the visual for them to be able to see, then they'll really understand. And so as we left that scene where Israel coming out of Egypt represents God in relationship with his people. Then now they've entered into this land where they are and they're cheating on him, but yet he's still going to call them back. Now in chapter 3, we see it happening in the physical with Hosea and the bride that he took. It said, because essentially what's happening right now is that even though he was married to her, she's cheated on him again. And now he has to go. And he has to go find her. So it says right here, chapter 3. Then said the Lord unto me, go yet, love a woman, beloved of her friend, an adulteress, according to the love of the Lord, toward the children of Israel, who look to other gods and love flagons of wine. You see that right there? That tells us right there that this is specifically what God has in mind. God specifically told Hosea to marry this woman so that he could exhibit a love towards her in the same fashion that he exhibits love towards his people. Because he said, look at what he said, an adulteress. And he says, I want you to love her according to the love of the Lord toward the children of Israel who look to other gods and love flagons of wine. That's all part of their worship in these false gods. Verse 2. So I bought her to me for 15 pieces of silver and for a homer of barley and a half a homer of barley. And I said unto her, thou shalt abide for me many days. Thou shalt not play the harlot, and thou shalt not be for another man. So will I also be for thee. For the children of Israel shall abide many days without a king, and without a prince, and without a sacrifice, without an image, without an ephod, without a teraphim. Afterward, the children of Israel return and seek the Lord their God and David their king, and shall fear the Lord and his goodness in the latter days. So all that at the end comes back to the promises of God regarding David and the Messiah. Amen. And so there's a period of time where there's various things that are taking place. So we started off the message, really, and so I titled this morning's message, I'll be honest with you, the lover of your soul. That's how the Lord gave me the message. First off, the Lord gave me, I knew he wanted me to preach somehow about the lover of your soul. And then I didn't have a clue where to go. And the Lord spoke to me and said, Hosea. So the Lord definitely wanted me to preach Hosea to you this morning. Whether you get the lover of your soul out of this, I hope you do. But at the same time, that's what you need to know this morning. You need to know that Jesus is the lover of your soul. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. And that in this story right here, you and I can learn and better understand the love of God if we can walk away with a little bit of a better understanding of this story. In Hosea chapter 1 verse 2, the beginning of the word of the Lord by Hosea, and the Lord said to Hosea, go take unto thee a wife of whoredoms and children of whoredoms, for the land has committed great whoredom departing from the Lord. He goes on to name these children, and I want you to tell you what their names are. Jezreel literally means to sow seed. Alright, so I want you to know that. Jezreel means to sow seed. Just, you ever seen a picture in the old days of people sowing seed? They used to have them pouches and they'd reach in there and they'd grab seed and they'd sling seed. We see all types of parables. There's a parable called the sower, right? And it's about Jesus. A sower went out to sow, and some fell along the wayside. Some fell upon rocky ground. Some fell amongst the thorns. I was talking about Jesus. The seed was the word of God. So Jezreel's name literally means to sow seed. And one of the things that you and I know I've said this many times, but I know people forget, that throughout the scriptures, there's once again another theme that's recurrent, and it's an agricultural concept that God is going to cause a harvest to take place from this earth, and the harvest isn't corn, the harvest isn't grape, the harvest isn't olives, the harvest is people, souls, amen? And that's part of his plan. He's sowing a people into the ground of this earth. He's cultivating a crop. He desires and plans to get a return on his work and his effort. He has created a plan by which man can be saved through sin and have a relationship with him and live with him for all eternity. So the first child's name was to sow seed. Second child's name, Lo-ruhamah, means no mercy. And the third child's name, Lo-ammi, means you are not my people and I am not your God. Now, I have to tell you that as I read this on the surface, I'm like, okay, Lord, you got me here, because you named the first child's name is Jezreel, to sow seed. And we understand that God's got a big old plan. And his plan is to create, to bring forth the harvest of humanity. But at the same time, he's sitting here saying that I will not have mercy on you. You're not my people and I'm not your God. And so the question has to be asked, Lord, why in the world? Because let me tell you why it has to be asked. Because there's people out there that ask the question. And I've had them ask it many a times. What kind of a God would create human beings and then leave them to themselves in order to go about this big old mess? That's the whole point. He gave them a free will and they started to make choices. But I'm here to tell you that in Isaiah chapter 5, if you could put that up or if you could turn there, Isaiah chapter 5, verses 3 through 6, I believe this passage of scripture explains the heart of God. Whenever he looks at the fact that seeds been sown and things have turned into a mess. He says, and what's interesting is that Isaiah and Hosea were contemporaries. They prophesied at the same time. Their time frame was exactly the same. Hosea was considered a minor prophet. Isaiah was the big name on the stage. Everybody knew who he was. But in Isaiah chapter 5, verses 3 through 6, this is the Lord that speaks through the prophet Isaiah. He says, and now, O inhabitants of Jerusalem and men of Judah, judge, I pray you. In other words, I'm begging you to make a judgment. I want you to judge betwixt or between me and my vineyard. What could have been done more to my vineyard that I have not done into it? In other words, he's wanting to ask a question to everybody. This is my vineyard, this is me. I want you to look at my vineyard and I want you to judge between the two of us. Is it my fault or is it their fault? Because he goes on to say, wherefore when I looked that it should bring forth grapes, brought it forth wild grapes. In other words, he's saying, I didn't sow wild grapes. I sowed cultivated grape seed. But the reality of it is that the choices that it made, the decisions that it made to go after false gods, to go after the resources of the world, to live their lives contrary to the word that I had given them, it turned them into a form of a wild grape rather than the cultivated kind that I planted in the ground. And because of that, he goes on to say, what do you think I should do with my vineyard now? He said, well, I'm going to tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to take away the hedge thereof. What does that mean? It means that he had previously built a wall of protection. So when he asked them, would you judge between me and my vineyard and you tell me who's at fault here? He had already built a nice hedge of protection for them. God, in his sovereign kindness and in the New Testament, through the power of the Holy Spirit, builds a protection for you and I. Amen. The Holy Spirit will go to work for us. He will protect us against the works of the enemy in our life if we will trust him and keep our faith in Jesus Christ and what he did for us at the cross, understanding that we in and of ourselves can't do it. He says, but I'm going to take the hedge away. And he says, it's going to be eaten up. I'm going to break down the wall. It's going to be trodden down. I'm not going to prune it. I'm not going to dig anymore. I'm not going to take care of it. I'm not going to pull out the briars and the thorns. I also will command the clouds that they no more rain upon it. So in other words, what he's trying to say is this, is that whenever Jezreel means to sow and we see no more mercy, you're not my people, you're not my God, it's not God's fault. God's trying to say this, I created you with a free will. Why? Because I didn't want a robot. Why? Because I wanted, I am love, and I wanted some, a creation that can reciprocate love to me. You're either going to make a choice to love me and live for me, or you're going to make a choice to go another way. And that's what the word of the Lord would say. Essentially, we should know that God didn't go through all this great work, amen, of creating this plant, of creating this harvest in order to just throw it all away. But like we said, no, within the story, he had created a people out of Egypt. He had delivered them out. And now the Lord is wanting them to trust him. We already went through the Leviticus passage where it says that when I bring you in there, I don't want you to do what it is that they've done. But that's exactly what they did. And once again, the people of God still do the same thing today. They look to the world for wisdom. They look to the world for wisdom and counseling in the midst of their social issues, in the midst of their relationship with issues, in the midst of their financial issues. I ended up scribbling that down there just this morning. You know, I talk about this probably more than some people, but I was thinking about two different things. Because this is a place where people live financially, and maybe it's because it's on my mind a lot. But you know, the Word of God said this. The Word of God said not to use usury. You know what that means. Not to live your life according to interest. Now, I got to tell you that I myself have been relatively, for the most part, disobedient in that. Now, I understand what society says. How am I going to buy a house if I don't? Well, I know some people that saved up enough money and did it enough themselves to where they have houses debt-free and they don't owe the bank anything. Now, I understand that's a story for another time. I'm not trying to beat you up, okay? That's not how I bought my house. But what I am trying to say is this, is that there are people that live their lives, and I know because I've been there, in such a way that usury or interest has become their master. You understand what I'm saying? Interest has become their master. They are in so much debt that interest has become their master, and God never intended for his people to live that way. Not only that, let me tell you this. The Word of God also says, owe no man anything. But at the same time, you know how many people today don't even pay their bills? They could care less that they owe other people money. Let me tell you something. That's a problem. The world system says you don't have to worry about your credit. The world system doesn't say says you don't have to worry about your name. But I'm over here telling you that if you live for God and you tell people you live for God, then guess what? You are a representative of his kingdom. Amen. And the choices that you make and the way that you live your life has a reflection directly upon him. Oh, but the world doesn't. And now everybody does it. People show up at the emergency room. I know because I work there, and they could care less. I have to be bleeding to go to an emergency room. You know why? Because it's going to cost you at least $1,200 when you walk up in there. You got $1,200 laying around just to throw at something? No, you ain't going over there for a cold. But many people go over there just for a cold. People that don't even have insurance. Why? This is going to mess up your credit, man. Credit. Who cares about their credit? Who cares about their name? Their credit's already so messed up. Their name's already so messed up. They don't care. They will go to the emergency room for a cold to get a steroid shot. How you wrap your mind around that and think, I don't understand that, but that's where society is. Society is in the midst of that circumstance and situation, and because everybody else is doing it, then I suppose that it's okay for everybody. No, it's not okay for the people of God. Now, I'm not trying to tell you, don't go get, that's between you and the Lord, how you get your medical treatment. The point that I'm trying to make is that we're making decisions based upon what the world says is wisdom, rather than what God's word says is wisdom. And that's what the children of God were doing at that point in time in the midst of their life. Now, what I want you to know is that we talked about those, the names of those sons, now our children. Now I want you to know what the name Hosea means. It's actually a variant of the name Joshua. Joshua means deliverer and salvation. So literally, Joshua is a type of Christ. Hosea is a type of Christ. Hosea is going to deliver, amen, and allow salvation to take place in somebody's life. God's going to use him to do that. Hosea in this story is a type of Christ. And once again, if we don't remember anything about this message this morning, I hope you'll remember that God's great plan of salvation is built upon a type of love that you and I in our natural mind can't understand. Without the help of the Holy Spirit, you and I will never be able to wrap our minds around or comprehend the love of God and the nature of how sacrificial it is, how giving it is. We need the Holy Spirit to open up our eyes and to allow us to see what His love really looks like. Because what most people do when they read chapters 1 and 2 of Hosea, all they see is the terminology of a God that's angry and is going to judge. But they don't see what in reality God's people have done to Him. And they don't see the part that even in the midst of what God's people have done to Him, He's still going to love them. He's still going to save them. He's still going to redeem them. He desires for them to have a relationship with them. Amen. He tells this prophet to marry a wife who's an adulteress and will continue to commit adultery. Now, one of the only things that I can even imagine is that God wants the man of God to feel the pain that he's feeling. Amen. Have you ever thought about the fact that God feels pain? Amen. Sometimes we go about our life and we can cause pain in other people's lives, but I can assure you, if we're causing pain in other people's lives, we're also causing pain in God's heart. God feels, amen. And here's the situation. He wants the man of God to feel what it is that he's feeling. He wants Hosea to exhibit a supernatural and forgiving love for Gomer in spite of all the adulteries that she commits. He wants the prophet and the people to see that his love is forgiving and unending. He wants them to know that no matter how far they've gone, they can come back to him. His plan was that they would be his people, not that they would be destroyed. Amen? First point that I want you that I want to give to you this morning, actually, is I titled it, When God Turns Trouble into Triumph. And out of Hosea chapter 1, verses 8 through 10, and also in Hosea chapter 2, verses 14 through 15, there's two points that I want to make about that when God turns trouble into triumph. So in Hosea 1, 8 through 10, it says right here, Now when she had weaned Lo-ruhamah, she conceived and bare a son. And then said God, Call his name Lo-ammi, for you are not my people, and I will not be your God. Yet the number of the, see that conjunction right there, yet. It's almost kind of like a but. Even though this, even still, this right here is going to happen. Yet the number of the children of Israel shall be as the sand of the sea. Even though these people, where they are right now in the midst of their life, are living their lives in such a way that they're saying, I'm going to tell them, you are not my people and I am not going to be your God. Even still, the children of Israel will be as the sand of the sea, which cannot be measured nor numbered. And it shall come to pass, this is what I want you to see, that in the very place where it was said unto them, you are not my people, there it shall be said unto them, you are the sons of the living God. In the same exact place where God said, you are not my people, in that place, God says, I will then call you and say to you that you are my people and that indeed I am your God. Amen. Now in chapter 2, verses 14 through 15, I want you to be reminded of this passage we read. God says, therefore, behold, I will allure her. I'm going to call upon her. I'm going to entice her. I'm going to bring her into the wilderness and speak comfortably unto her. And I will give her vineyards from there and the valley of Achor for a door of hope. And she shall sing there as in the days of her youth and as in the day when she came up out of the land. So two spots where God turns trouble into triumph. Number one, in the same place where he said they weren't his people, he's going to say they are his people. Number two, he's going to turn the valley of Achor into a door of hope. What I need you to know is this, is that whenever we find ourselves in the midst of painful circumstances, when the people of God find themselves in the midst of painful circumstances, it's right there, right then, that they really will begin to cry out upon the name of the Lord. I'm not done yet. Point two is going to clarify. Don't worry. Because I know a whole lot of people that say, and I've had people say to me, you see, I can get broken, huh? You saw how broken I was? There was a song that actually used to say this, rend your heart. Where the guy wrote a song and he said, I don't need a grand display. See, back in the Old Testament, what they would do is they would take their clothes and they would rip them and they'd put ashes all over their face and they would wail and they would cry on their knees. And the guy in the song would say, I don't need a grand display. I don't need you to start ripping your clothes. I don't need you to rub ashes all over your head. I need you to rend your heart. I need your heart to be torn and ripped. I need your heart to be opened up. And people would say, oh, I'm in the midst of painful circumstances. I'm really going to cry out on God right now. Hold on, we're not done. Point two is going to clarify. But what I want you to know is this. In that same place where I said you were not my people, that's the same place I'm going to say that you are my people. Why? Because when God's people start getting in trouble, they start to cry upon the Lord. Number two, part B, is that I'm going to turn the Valley of Achor into a door of hope. See, the Valley of Achor, if you'll remember the story, in the time frame of Joshua, whenever God was bringing the children of Israel into the promised land, Achan took of the accursed thing. Remember that? God said, do not take of the accursed thing. Don't take the property of the people that I'm about to bring you into and to destroy their I don't want you taking these various things because those things belong to me. What Achan did was he went and he dug a hole in the ground under his tent and he hid all that stuff. And because of that, the children of Israel, while they had won a battle in Jericho, found themselves losing in Ai. And come to find out the reason why was because Achan had taken of the accursed thing. So what did God do? He marched the whole nation down to the Valley of Achor, which means trouble. Achan's name meant trouble, and the valley was named trouble because it was there that God destroyed Achan and dealt with the sin that had brought destruction upon the people of God. See, so this is the thing that I want you to know is that it's in the midst of the trouble that God turns trouble into a door of hope. See, God's people now, in the time frame of Hosea, he's reminding them, you're in a time frame where you're being disobedient to me. You're being adulterous to me. You're spiritually not walking or living for me. But I have good news that in the same place where you were in the midst of your trouble, I'm going to turn that into a door of hope. It's going to be a place where you're going to be able to move into the spiritual promises that I have for you. In the New Testament, God says in Romans 8:28 that he causes all things to work together to good for those that love him. Amen. So you and I need to know that many times throughout our life, and in many circumstances, we'll find ourselves in the midst of pain, just like Israel at this point. Even though it's self-inflicted a lot of times, we find ourselves in pain, and we come to this place where we begin to cry out upon the Lord. Amen. And God promises that whenever we do that, he's going to turn the trouble into a door of hope. Amen. So I don't know where you are. Hey, preacher, you're not preaching to me today. Everything's smooth sailing. Well, guess what? Hold on, Christian, because you might find yourself in the midst of a place where you find in the Valley of Achor, a place of trouble, and where God wants you to do when you get there, he wants you to cry out to him. Amen. And he doesn't just want a grand display. He wants you to rend your heart. He wants you to rip your heart in his presence and to cry out to him and to ask him, Lord, I want you to be my God and I want to be your people. Listen, he told the prophet Jeremiah, chapter 29, verses 11 through 14. See, whenever the people of God find themselves in great trouble in circumstances like that, they'll cry out to him. In the book of Jeremiah, God kept warning the people that they would be in captivity, and sure enough, that's what happened. But this is God's plan. See, just as God's, the name of Jezreel means to sow seed, and just as it also means that the reality is that he didn't want to be their people because of the way they were acting, that in this prophecy, see, most of y'all know about the scripture, right? Y'all got that one on y'all's refrigerator. A lot of people quote this one right here. Oh, and I remember when they first started quoting it. Oh, the Lord's going to bless me. He said, the Lord knows the thoughts that he thinks towards me. They're thoughts of good and not of evil. He's going to give me a future and a hope. But when God's saying this, his people are captive to Babylon. So even in the midst of their captivity, yes, God is speaking to them and saying, I know the thoughts that I think towards you, says the Lord. Thoughts of peace, not of evil. To give you an expected end. Some translations say, a future and a hope. Then shall you call upon me, and you shall go and pray unto me, and I will hearken unto you. You shall seek me and find me when you shall search for me with all your heart, and I will be found of you, says the Lord, and I will turn away your captivity. So you understand what's going on here. It's not just God saying, oh, I got this beautiful plan for you. No, I always had a beautiful plan for you. You made choices that inflicted yourself. You made choices that put yourself in captivity. And when you find yourself in the midst of that captivity in troublesome times, you're going to call upon me, hallelujah, from the midst of your broken heart, and then I'm going to hearken unto you. Because see, you weren't hearkening to me. I'll preach it to the preacher too. Y'all just don't know it. See, because you weren't hearkening unto me. You weren't listening to the voice that I was speaking unto you. But now that you find yourself in trouble sometimes, now that you find yourself in captivity, now that you've been driven to your knees, and you cry out to me with a broken heart, then I'm going to hearken unto you. I'm going to listen to you. And my plans for your life are going to come to pass. Amen. The truth is that just as Israel was God's people, but we're not completely being faithful to him, we also, like I said, have done the same. And there's seasons in our lives. At first I had in here where we struggle with sin. But you know what I did? I scratched it out. And I said, no, instead, there are seasons in our lives where we live in sin. Because there's a big difference between struggling in sin and living in sin.
Amen.
We can get so, look, dude, I'm telling you, we can start becoming a wordsmith with God. We start taking little words and then we just plug it in where we want to plug it in. And we're like, oh, I'm just struggling. No, there's a difference between struggling and living. The struggle means in your heart and in your mind and in your the desires of your very being is you don't want to be where you are. But you can start to confuse yourself and even trick yourself into thinking, oh man, I'm just struggling because I don't want to be here. When in reality, no, you like it when you go there still.
Yeah, come on.
You still like it when you go. You still like to call upon the name of Balaam every now and then. You still like to wrap your arms around him and feel what it is that he's given you whenever you seek after to fulfill and gratify the lust of your flesh.
Yeah.
Whatever it is that makes you feel good. Come on, somebody, help me out here. I'm just trying to preach the gospel. I'm just trying to tell you what the Lord, hallelujah, wrote in his word. Amen. Don't get mad at the preacher. And so there's a big difference between struggling and living in it.
Amen.
And the reality of it is that God don't want his people living in it.
Amen.
And whenever you're in a real struggle and you're wanting freedom from it, the Lord will give you freedom. But you're going to have to get past the place of living. And you're going to have to get to the place of a real struggle.
Amen.
Where you're saying, Lord, I want you to set me free. And whenever you do that, hallelujah, the Lord will begin to move on your behalf. For you and I, we need to understand that he has already set us free. Amen. He made a way through what Jesus did at the cross. In Romans chapter 6, verses 18, actually through 22, he says this. Being then made free from sin, you became the servants of righteousness. Jesus has already done the work. He's already destroyed the forces of evil. And so there's supposed to be a point where the life of the Christian goes from being a slave of sin to a slave of righteousness.
Yes, yes.
Where he no longer produces all lust of the flesh all day long, but instead fruit of the Spirit. Where he quits living as much for himself and starts living for the Lord.
Yes.
Amen? He goes on to say in verse 22, but now being made free from sin. You've been free.
Yes.
You used to be in Babylonian captivity. You used to be an Egyptian slave, but I set you free. And now that you've been made free, hallelujah, through the shedding of the blood of the Lamb, you're supposed to be a servant of righteousness. Not in your own strength. I'm not even asking you to do it in your own strength. I'm here to tell you, I got a plan where I give you the strength that you need, where I empower you, where I give you my Holy Spirit to dwell in you, to move in you, and to give you freedom, amen, where that place of trouble, when you fall on your knees and you cry out to me, that I will begin to move on your behalf, and you will start working for me. Hallelujah. You will become a servant of righteousness. He says right here, you have your fruit unto holiness, and the end thereof is everlasting life.
Yes,
see, how oftentimes do we really trade in for this momentary pleasure? It's not everlasting life. It's temporary pleasure. The lust of the flesh is temporary pleasure. I'm just going to get a little moment out of this thing. Listen, we've all been there, dude. I know. We've all been there. It's a moment of pleasure. And we got this battle that rages, and sometimes it affects us. Some things affect us worse than other things, right? But the reality of it is that it's the difference. It's the mindset to be convinced that God has called us to be His people, and that He's creating an eternal family, and that there's a harvest ahead. Amen?
Amen?
Praise
Amen.
God. Just as God promised that He would call them His people in the Hosea passage, we learn here in Romans that the believer experiences freedom from bondage of sin. He desires to be a servant of righteousness. He desires to become a true servant of God. And it's all part of God revealing His love towards us. Amen? In the midst of that struggle, in the midst of that time frame, God is desiring to reveal His love to us. He allows us to go through these things. It's part of the convincing the free will. That's why whenever He told him, He said, she's going to run after her lovers. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to put a hedge of thorns up. This is only for the child of God. This is not for the Canaanite. I'm telling you right now, the Canaanite that's never been saved doesn't know the first thing I'm talking about. The child of God that's been heading in a certain direction, seeking after the lust of the flesh, and finding themselves with a hedge of thorns, an obstacle in the way, preventing them from being able to truly be fulfilled through what it is that they're seeking after. You know exactly what I'm talking about. Because you keep on waking up empty and depleted of any hope when you keep on seeking after and searching after those things that will not bring you the fulfillment
Amen.
That your heart is looking for. It's all part of God's plan. He allows it to happen. Does He want it to happen? No. Is it His perfect will? It's not even His will that we would go
Amen.
That way. But He knows how to operate even in the midst of our disobedience. That's how much God loves you. I know I don't do a very good job of really communicating the love of God or get all excited and everything. But I need you to know that's how much God loves you. That's how much God loves me. He would give us a free will. And even in the midst of our disobedience, He would allow things to happen to prove to us the whole time He's working. The whole time He's doing what He does.
Amen.
He's saying, when I do this, 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 and this, finally, when they get right here, bam, that's what it's going to happen.
Amen.
It's going to start off, they're going to get frustrated in the valley of Achor, and they're going to fall on their knees. And that's the place right there. Trouble, that's when it's going to start. It's going to become a door of hope right there in the midst of that place, right? But the point number two is this. I call point number two trading in lust for love. Trading in lust for love. See, when you begin to see what you're really doing to yourself and to God, and you begin to see the love of God and what He's done for you, there comes a time when something happens to the heart.
Mm-hmm.
And you begin to desire to trade in your lust. What does lust mean? So don't think sexually all the time. Lust is literally, in the Greek language, a unholy desire for something that you're not supposed to want. Anything that stands in between you and God, anything that you desire to hold on to bring you comfort or to fulfill your needs, that is contrary to the word of God, is a lust in the eyes of God.
Amen.
It's a desire for something that's contrary to the ways of God. Amen? And the Holy Spirit will reveal those things to us. But in Hosea chapter 2, verses 16 through 17, this is where the Lord said this. He said, "It shall be at that day, says the Lord, that you shall call me Ishi," which means husband. "And you shall no longer call me Bailey.
Yeah.
For I will take away the names of Balaam out of her mouth, and they shall no more be remembered by their name." So you can come to the place of Achor. You can come to the valley of trouble. You can come to the place of negative circumstances that cause pain. And you can say, God, I don't want to be here anymore. But the Lord knows that you still every now and then, come on, you can't hide nothing from Him. I know this to be true because I've seen it in my own life. The Lord knows you still call Him Bailey every now and then. By the little, in other words, you still call upon that other name. But the Lord says that there comes a spot in the midst of the troublesome times, in the midst of the circumstances, where it's not just words anymore, but the reality of it is that it's touched the heart so deep that we come to the place where we call Him husband, right? Where we call upon the Lord, where we cry, Lord, oh Lord, I call upon you. Lord, I desire to do what is right in your eyes. I desire to have a heart. I no longer want to have the relationship with those things that have, you no longer desire those things, because you begin to realize what it is that they're doing to you. You begin to realize what it is that it's doing to the heart of the Lord. And you begin to have a desire to trade in lust for love. Previously, Israel had pursued the false gods of the Canaanite in hope that Baal would give her rain. And as we stated, the believer desperately searches for so much of what the world offers only to be left empty time and again. But God said that was the place. The place where she cheated is where she would be restored. The trouble would be the door to hope. Here she will call Him husband. In this place she will have become convinced that God is the most important thing in her life. Amen. And her lust to make herself feel good would be exchanged for a desire to please the Lord. She will honor her covenant with God and call Him husband. And so part of that process of coming to the end required her to be convinced of her own free will that what Baal or the world offered wasn't what she wanted. Instead, she wanted the husband that loved her and was faithful to her even when she wasn't faithful to him. Surely here she sees herself. She sees her failures and the hurt she caused. She sees the response of God was only love, and again, in a state of exhaustion and filled with failure, she falls onto her knees and she cries out and says, enough, enough, my husband, I'm tired of cheating on you. I want to live for you alone. Now, I got to tell you that there's a beautiful thing that happens in this relationship with the Lord when this place takes, when this takes place. And all the games are gone now, right here. And when this takes place, something supernatural kicks in again. You remember how previously she was looking to try to find through the resources of the world the answers to the things that she needed? Whatever it is. I need to go to the bank. I got to get another consolidation loan. I got to go. You know, I keep thinking of finances. I got to go try to patch this thing up. I got to fix this thing over here. I got to go get something to numb my pain. Come on, somebody, help me out here. Whatever it may be. But at this place, when she falls on her knees in desperation, she's tired of going to another place. For me, one of the things that the Lord did for me a long time ago was the Lord told me to quit taking money from my dad. I mean, my dad was offering the money. It was before he passed away. My dad, I hung up the phone. I remember one time the Lord said, it's time you know who your daddy is, boy. God knows how to speak to people. And through that, I got from that. And I can tell you, I told my wife about it. He didn't say quit taking money from your daddy. He said, it's time for you to know who your daddy is, boy.
Yes.
And whenever he spoke that to me, I knew I was to no longer take another dime from him. Because he was trying to show me that he was my source. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
That he was trying to, it was a major spiritual concept in my life.
Mm-hmm.
But he's willing to give me the money. The problem is you're never going to learn how to take care of your own business. You're never going to grow up. Because you're over here dependent upon everybody else. It's time that you learn to trust me. It's time that you learn to let me discipline you. It's time that you learn to let me have my way in the midst of your life. But a beautiful thing happens whenever we get to this place. In this part of the relationship, whether it be Israel with her God or Christian with his God, there's something that happens. But God begins to move supernaturally on their behalf. He begins to bring healing and deliverance. He begins to bring freedom and a release from bondage and captivity. I can remember one time whenever I was young and I was in the oil field, and I remember jogging in Venezuela. And one of the things that I noticed, and I don't really know why, I really remember that. I wrote papers about it later on when I was in school. There was the fruit would just fall from the trees. It would get ripe, And it would just fall from the tree and there would rot on the sidewalk because nobody cared. I mean, everybody had fruit trees in their own yard. There was that much fruit just falling from the trees. And later, when the Lord began to do a work in my life, and that there were bondages that had been in my life that I had tried to get free from, whether I was going up to the front like I told y'all before and the preacher was going to lay his hands on me, or I was going to do this or that or whatever was going to supposedly set me free, and I wasn't really being set free, the Lord reminded me of that fruit falling off that tree. Because He began to do the work. He began to pluck it away. It was something that I could have never done. I could have never accomplished what God was doing. Like rotten fruit that falls off a tree is how the Lord was doing it in my life. It was through the grace of the Holy Spirit. Jesus had already purchased freedom and victory. And now the grace of the Lord was moving on my behalf and beginning to clean it out. What I wanted to show you is this. In Hosea chapter 2, verses 19 through 23. It says right here, I will betroth you unto me forever. Yea, I will betroth you unto me in righteousness and in judgment, and in loving kindness and in mercies. I will even betroth you unto me in faithfulness. And you shall know the Lord, and it shall come to pass in that day, I will hear, says the Lord, I will hear the heavens, and they shall hear the earth. And the earth shall hear the corn, and the wine and the oil, and they shall hear Jezreel, means seed, right? Jezreel. And I will sow her unto me in the earth. I will have mercy upon her that had not obtained mercy. I will say to them which were not my people, thou art my people. And they shall say, thou art my God. What am I trying to say? I'm trying to say that previously, they're all getting caught up in this Canaanite worship. They're getting caught up in worshiping Baal, crying out to the world to give them rain for their agriculture. God's saying, if you'll just line up with me, if you will allow your heart to be broken in my presence and line up in your relationship with me, I'm the one that created all of this. And just as the seed cries out, I need some moisture down here in the earth, and he cries out, I want to be an ear of corn, and the corn says to the earth, I need some moisture in order to be sustained, and the earth cries out to the heavens, hey, we need some moisture down here, and the heavens cry out and say, hey, you created me to produce moisture, but there's no clouds in the sky. God said, I will hear the heavens that are hearing from the earth, that are hearing from the corn, that are hearing from the seed, and I will open up the heavens, and I will pour out rain. I will do supernaturally and spiritually for you what you could have never done for yourself, what your lovers could have never given you, what the resources from the world could have never given you, whatever it was that you were seeking from them, and the hope that you were hoping to receive from them, I will show up. Amen. And supernaturally, spiritually, in one moment of time, begin to bring deliverance in the midst of your life. A supernatural chain reaction takes place. He hears the heavens, he cries, he responds with rain. Oh, Jezreel, seed of God. He's crying out. Listen, I'm not even going to have time to finish the rest of my message. Maybe I'll preach it tonight. I don't know. I'll see. But what I want you to know is this, is that God has a plan. God has a beautiful plan, amen, where he desires for his people to come to a place where they're no longer running after things that are going to make them feel good, where they're no longer cheating on him in the midst of those circumstances. Really and truly, it's the end of the chapter 3 is the most beautiful picture, because even in the midst of all that, even in the midst of all that she's done to him, God still loves her. He still loves her with his heart. I think we're going to finish it up today.